If I can replicate anyone talking, now or in history, by feeding enough of their speech or talking or whatever into ChatGPT, and if I speak with ChatGPT long enough, it stands to reason that OpenAI should be able to replicate me any way I speak, I talk, I look, I... They would easily be able to have a profile and an AI bot that speaks and talks and sounds and looks just like me. With pretty much 15 years history of me wailing into the void of the social media interwebs, I could use my social media comments and posts and engagements, and I could theoretically use those as source information to predict my own actions. I can only imagine what these corporations that have all my data, and now an AI replica of me, could have on me now. And I know some of you are like, okay, Charlie, you're being a little bit of a fear-mongering alarmist right now. Well, I certainly don't mean to be fear-mongering, thinking all apocalyptically. Yeah, because what's the worst that could happen? Or do I mean to be apocalyptic? Let's take a cold, hard look into the mirror. No, the Black Mirror. Do you remember all those Black Mirror episodes? Remember what a cerebral roller coaster that was? That dopamine-fueled, raging mind-bender of an assault on the future that's to come? Yeah, I remember. I remember that one Black Mirror episode, the one with John Hamm, the one where they make a copy of people and it's John Hamm's job to train them to become their personal assistant to control their lights and their toaster and their other things and appliances using, let's say, less than ethical training practices. And I remember that in the Men Against Fire episode of Black Mirror, the one where the soldier has an implant that makes him see the enemy as mutated because allegedly it helps maintain the soldier's general moral disdain for the enemy. And I remember the 15 million credits episode where millions of people without explanation are just bottled up in a set of what seem like endless dormitories where everyone is forced to bicycle endlessly until they generate some form of easily packageable content with their face, with their voice, with their emotional range, easily packageable content that affords them an increasing comfort of living. Win hot shots! If they can do that is. Until I caught a glimpse of the Easter eggs for the Hotshot talent show and other episodes that seemed like they were in the real world, I was completely blind to what I now really think was going on in the show. But now I'm certain that some of the characters in what seem like different worlds in Black Mirrors might really be virtual worlds and AI human copy replicators that are allowed to play out for human research.
You know? For a petri dish, this ain't half bad.
Think about the White Christmas episode where they got a suspect to confess to a crime in minutes. But in AI scale time, ages. Here's my question though. Where did that AI profile go after the confession? I mean, praise be John Hamm and his gorgeous face, but there's even a part where he makes light of how some of the profiles break and become unstable.
And then end up getting sold off to the military for war games.
For war games. War games where they fight endlessly to see who could destroy that subscribe button. So I have to ask myself now, is OpenAI or Google or whoever going to do already doing that to me? Or rather, digital me? And
hard slash.
Or maybe is it even possible that the government has already done this? I don't know, but it's cool to think about if they could. This also has me contemplating the Hulu original show Devs. Praise be Nick Offerman and everything he does. Regret nothing. The end.
The universe is deterministic.
So, sorry?
An effect is always the result of a prior cause. Our feelings, our opinions, judgments, decisions. Those decisions can only have been the result of something prior. Where you were born, how you were brought up. At the end of the day, cause and effect. I know it doesn't feel that way, Sergey. And we feel so certain about our subjective state.
The sense that you were participating in life was only ever an illusion.
You knew I was going to come here.
This is your station.
But what am I actually doing here?
Don't worry. You're gonna figure it out.
You ask, what is Devs? Take a computer. Give it all the data that can exist about this pen rolling across the table. Its trajectory, velocity, mass of its component parts, atomic structure. It can tell you how hard the pen was pushed, and it can tell you when the pen will stop rolling. The computer can see backwards. The computer can see forwards. Now do that with everything. That's Debs.
If I have a working quantum computer and an AI profile bot of just about every person, and then I pile on the bacon bits of having nearly a full-scale 3D model of the entire Earth.
Why don't I feel good about it?
That would be your unconscious mind speaking to you. And what it's saying is, uh-oh. Because a few hours ago, we were in reality and we were working on a sim. And now we've pretty much traded. That's the reality.
What's inside?
Everything. Right there. It's not even a clone of reality. The box contains everything. The box contains us. The box contains everything.
The physical construction of your particular brain. It's the nature-nurture matrix.
Ad infinitum, ad nauseum. Uh-oh.
I hope you understand what I'm saying, Sergey. It's more complex, more nuanced, but still.
If I could do exactly what the characters of Devs were doing with their quantum computer,
to be able to fully forecast and backcast all human actions.
This is basically the premise of Minority Report. If another government would invade our country, this'd be the absolute best defensive technique.
Heart slash.
Tactical weapon to have against your enemy.
All I need is 10 years of social media chaos, a buzzword, knee-jerk reaction, dopamine flooding, content that we consume and react to while they poke and prod and record our reactions.
Just like in the Animatrix.
We might not be in the Matrix, but a version of us might already be in one.
Are you okay with that?
Whoa.
Okay, so let's talk about the superintelligence for a moment.
I think it takes like unique human arrogance to believe that AI cannot supersede humans.
If we define the superintelligence as when AI becomes smarter than all humans combined, and if it's only a matter of time before OpenAI or Google or has a copy of all humans and nearly all variations of them, then it stands to reason that we don't need an AI to be super intelligent. We just need a normal AI who has every human mind to source from. Real talk, this might make that possible. Might it already be possible? I don't know, but pretty mind-blowing to think about, eh? For real though, I could one day make copies of my loved ones. My best friend, my deceased father, my grandparents. We might one day be able to copy our most intelligent scientists, or our deadliest soldiers, or even I might be able to copy my worst enemy. That I can torture over and over. Figure out what makes them tick. Figure out how to manipulate them. Figure out their worst nightmares. Figure them out with a copy I made of them with their social media accounts. Now consider the actual autonomous robots that are coming out right now, like from Boston Dynamics. Just listen to what Alex Hormozzi has to say about this.
The next important milestone is when AI actually enters the physical world. Elon revealed the Tesla bot. The thing is that that's what it is today. Again, like the iPhone, in many machine generations, which happen faster than human generations, that will be able to look exactly like a human. And it will definitely, if you look at Boston Dynamics, there's robots that actually function better than humans, that have longer arms and are much stronger and can jump and don't need to sleep and won't have sexual complaints, blah, 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 blah. Once those machine generations happen on robotics and on the AI side, we'll reach a point where there's super intelligence. And at that point, the world will change significantly.
So let's regroup. Let's establish that you, or this version of you, is not in the Matrix, where agents can go beyond the limits of the construct, using their supernatural abilities to keep us in our place. However, if we make robots that have superhuman abilities, and if we make AI with superhuman consciousness, and we give one of those AI a body, are we bringing the Matrix into the real world?
I must get out of here, do you understand? I must get free.
So whether it's a copy of someone or a newly made AI, we're heading on a path that's leading to lots of unanswered ethical questions. My biggest question, though.
It's the question that drives us.
Who owns my copy and what it comes up with?
And in this mind is the key, my key.
Who owns what my copy invents?
You're going to tell me, or you're going to die.
Do the corporations who generate them own them?
I see you are as predictable in this world as you are in the other.
Do we as the originals own them?
Still don't recognize me.
Should anyone own it?
The answer is up there, Neo.
Should it be open sourced?
That's it, Mr. Anderson.
Look past the flesh. Look through the soft gelatin of these dull cow eyes.
Get me.
Oh yes, Mr. Anderson.
What do you want?
I want what you want.
Or do they, as autonomous entities, have their own rights?
It's impossible.
Not impossible. Inevitable.
The technology is immensely mechanical, and their human systems continue their demonstration in front of the Albany District Court in what has now been dubbed the Million Machine March.
I think if we don't start answering these ethical questions now, things aren't going to go well for any of us.
Okay, so I'm sure you're thinking now.
Wow, Charlie, that's great. What does that mean for me, and how can I use this to actually improve my inventions?
Now that GPT-3 is here, and soon GPT-4, it's changing how I and many other inventors do their work. Since university, I've spent the last decade figuring out how to bring my ideas and inventions into the world of business while working as a mostly self-funded independent inventor. I can't give you any specifics to what I've been making with AI just yet, but I can tell you that CAD programs already have AI generative capabilities built into them that can take your designs to the next level. Besides directly designing with CAD, I've been using ChatGPT to brainstorm new ideas and adaptations for each of my inventions.
It's been a great tool for coming up with new uses of my existing ideas.
I usually start by giving ChatGPT a little bit of context. That might be copying and pasting a patent and having it summarize it for me, so that it's fresh in its memory, and so each following response will be somewhere around that context. I'll maybe ask it to explain the background of a certain subject or topic, or maybe ask it to explain each of the specific components in a patent, to explain how the whole system works together. You know, build up a general basis for it to pull from for the ideas I want it to find new connections on. Then I describe the idea I have and how each part of it would work. And then I ask it to come up with new and unique uses for it that we hadn't already discussed. And, oh my gosh, Becky, look at those ideas! For real though, I've been glued to my computer screen for every second I can, until they cut me off and I hit the max number of prompts I'm allowed to do per hour. Did you know there was a limit?
Is your friend or loved one constantly glued to their phone, unable to resist the pull of ChatGPT? Do they turn to ChatGPT for advice on everything, from what to eat for breakfast to which socks to wear? If you've noticed these signs, they might be struggling with a ChatGPT addiction. Introducing the ChatGPT Addiction Hotline, here to help break the cycle and regain balance in their life. Call 1-800-GPT-HELP today and take the first step toward a ChatGPT balance future, because there's more to life than just AI-generated conversations. Disclaimer: this commercial is intended for comedic purposes and should not be taken seriously. ChatGPT is a useful tool when used responsibly.